Good morning.
Good morning.
It works. Okay. Maybe just a little bit. Okay. So, everything happens and you don't know why, but this system isn't working, so I'm going to use this system. So, bear with me. Let's try it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes. Welcome to Peterborough United Methodist Church. I would love for everyone to sign the pastoral connection cards. First time visitors, frequent visitor, member, it doesn't matter. I'm just thinking it's a great way for you to communicate with us, to let us know if you have a new email address or phone number, or if you have any suggestions at all. Because I'm up here and I talk to you, but I never get the chance for you to talk back to me. So that's what the connection card is all about. Our welcome card for guests has a digital welcome card thing right here. If you're one of those people that does everything on your cell phone, try it out. It works. We tried it and you can communicate with us in that way. We want to be sure that you have a way to communicate with us. Okay, a few introductions. I'm Kathleen Card. I'm the pastor here. Wendy Dunning is our choir director. If you like to sing, see her. We have a wonderful choir. Thank Jean Brochu, who is our organist and pianist. And follow along today with the liturgy with our liturgist, Jim Poplin. And also our adult Bible study at 11:15 is led by Jim. He's going to tell you a little bit more about what's coming. This is the last Sunday for the Advent class. The nursery is available from 9:30 to 11:30. Children are always welcome in service. And after the children's sermon, they can go to children's church, but I want everyone to know that children are always welcome in the service. It's okay. I didn't tell every single person what my changes were. So sorry. Okay, I need forgiveness today. So, this was my last announcement. We're going to have our ministry moments following this welcome, so don't be confused if we're going out of order in our bulletin.
Hello.
Hi, everyone. I'd like you to take a few moments to review the activities in your bulletin. We are very busy in this church, and there's a lot going on. Journey by Adam Hamilton, who is a wonderful speaker. We have a complimentary video that goes along with the story, and he explains it so beautifully. So if can you hear me over there? Sometimes? Okay, I think. Now it's time to go to God. Would you please join me in the responsive reading of the opening prayer printed in your bulletin? God made my life complete when I placed all the pieces before God. Together, and I'm watching my step.
God revealed the text of my life
when I open the book of my heart to God's eyes. Our first hymn today is found in the large blue hymnal, that is hymn number 2.5. Done great things. Holy is God's name. The light of the world is coming.
With Mary, our spirits rejoice in God our Savior.
God's mercy endures from generation to generation for those who are aware and who are in awe of God. Hungry are satisfied. We light a fourth candle in anticipation of the wondrous birth. Church. We acknowledge one baptism
for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and for the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you. Our first scripture reading is from the second book of Samuel. The books of Samuel cover Israel's traumatic period of transition of governance from the God-appointed judges to the hereditary monarchy. Saul, the first king of Israel, had lost favor in God's eyes, and so God chose David to succeed Saul. The second book of Samuel covers primarily the acceptance of David by the tribes of Israel and his reign from 1000 to 961 B.C. In this reading, David believes he should build a house of worship for God. The prophet Nathan agrees, but as we shall see, God has other plans. If you want to follow along, the text is in the page, is on page 268 in the Old Testament portion of the Pew Bible, or is printed in your bulletin. We are at 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 to 11. And the word is, "Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, 'See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent.' Nathan said to the king, 'Go do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you.' But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, 'Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all of the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people, Israel. And I have been with you whenever you went, wherever you went, and have cut off all of your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place, and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people, Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house." The word of God for the people of God.
Oh,
ugly, and maybe the Lord will put something on your heart. And let us pray the words the Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We've come to that part of the service where we return to God's church some of the abundance that God has blessed us with. Please let the ushers come forward to collect the offering. His sources included the apostles, who witnessed Jesus' ministry, the Gospel of Mark, and other writings available to him. Two important themes are present in this reading. First, a decree by the ruler of the known civilized world, as the Romans saw it, forced Joseph and Mary to travel to Bethlehem, the predicted birthplace of the Messiah, as foretold in Micah 5:2. Second, Joseph, as a member of the house of David, the bloodline of kings, embraces Jesus as his son. The text of this passage can be found on page 54 in the New Testament portion of your pew Bible or in your bulletin. We are in the Gospel of Luke, This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius, the governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for him. Next hymn in the Lord's Blue Hymnal, it is number 219. The child is this. Please stand as you are able for the singing of this wonderful hymn. Again, the number is 219.
Thank you.
eternal God, I ask that you get me out of the way and that you, through me, can bring a word in this very holy season. I pray this prayer in the name of your blessed Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So, Dick mentioned our Bible study on the journey, and we took the journey for 6 weeks. Those of you who are in Jim's class will finish the journey today. And we started out with Mary, a young woman betrothed to Joseph, and she learned that she was favored by God. And we learned that to be favored by God was not necessarily an easy thing, that it always meant there was something for you to do. And then we talked about Joseph, her husband, who has not a line in Scripture. He says nothing, but he does it all. And he takes care of Mary and his adopted son, Jesus. And then we talked about Elizabeth, Aunt Elizabeth, who was the one the angel said to Mary, your Aunt Elizabeth is pregnant, and she was way past childbearing age. It would be like I found out that I was pregnant. Not a good thing. And she's going to have John the Baptist. And we see how we get empirical, historical proof here that these messages that we get from angel or angelic messengers are in fact reliable. And then we walked the walk from Nazareth to Bethlehem, which we decided would probably be here to just past Jaffrey, take about 10 days walking in some really difficult terrain, and how arduous that would be for Joseph and Mary. And we closed with the manger. And we talked about how they were choosing hope. And Adam Hamilton has a great take on this. He talks about the prophet Zechariah describing us as Christians being prisoners of hope. Prisoners of hope. And he describes how Mary and Joseph are models for us, helping us to choose to believe that God will use our adversity, our disappointment, our heartache, and our painful journeys to accomplish God's purposes. And so when you were praying and you were saying to me, let's pray for the people who this is a difficult time of year for them, every one of us this year has had some difficult times. And I think if you really examine them, you understand that if we choose hope in difficult times, we can bring something out of it that is good. And that's what the Christmas story is all about. Hamilton talks about a family who had a boy named Matthew, and he had a rare genetic condition known as chromosome 22 ring. Matthew's parents were told that he would probably be a stillborn, but he wasn't. And he lived to be 21. And he was such a blessing to that family. Hamilton reminds us that the way their son was born, the deficiency that he had, would never be a choice that they would have made. However, he became a blessing to them, not just to them. They established a ministry in that church that has helped thousands of children with disabilities. So do you see where I'm going? Where Christmas is going? We are insatiable hopers. Not just that, we know how to celebrate. These poinsettias here are an example of God's extravagant love. Extravagant love for us. We are so loved, and we are to love others just as we are loved. That is the Christmas story. And so, finally, the last week, we were in the stable where Jesus was born. And people have all kinds of explanations about that stable. And was it a cave, maybe? And was it really that everybody was crowded and there was relatives and she was going to have a baby and she was going to be unclean? But then I'm going to turn to the scripture that Jim read so beautifully in 2 Samuel. And you're probably wondering, why in the world did she have us read 2 Samuel on Christmas Sunday? And I want to tell you truthfully, that's the lectionary for today. That's in the lectionary for today. And so I kept reading it and saying, well, what am I supposed to get out of this scripture if it's the lectionary? And then I remembered the Luke scripture that says, she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. And then I thought, maybe all these years we've gotten this wrong. You know how we feel really bad that Jesus was born in the manger? But maybe what Luke means, maybe what God wants us to see is that there is not any place large enough, magnificent enough to house God. Maybe, just like in David's day, the message to us is not that we have to build a huge home for God or a huge home for anything. Maybe the message is that God will never be contained. If you look into that 2 Samuel scripture, God reminds David that it was God who took David from the pasture, from following sheep to be the prince over God's people of Israel. And it was God who was with David when he went into battle. It was God cutting off David's enemies, and it was God making David great. And so here we are celebrating how God poured God's grace into the world and how we are not to use that grace ever for personal power or recognition. So when David tells Nathan, and he's got it backwards, usually you go to the prophet, you ask the prophet to go to God for you. But David goes to the prophet and he says, I have this great idea, and I'm going to build this house. God hasn't had a house. He's been going around in the tabernacle. And God answers him by saying, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I've not lived in a house since the day I brought the people of Israel up from Egypt. I've been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. So it seems to me that God wants David, and God wants us to know, God is not the recipient ever of our power. God is the provider. That's really important. It's really important when we begin to determine what God wants us to do. All too often, it's what we want to do, and we kind of put it around in a way that we get what we want, and we ignore what God wants. And so on this Sunday before Christmas, we need to remember, God will never be contained in a building. I don't care what building it is. You cannot put a box around God. And God chooses who God wants to reveal God's covenant. And he used David as a shepherd. He doesn't pick the powerful. He empowers the powerless. And God's prevenient grace acts as a corrective if, as David got picked and he's doing pretty good, and he starts feeling really good about himself, and he says, oh, well, hey, I think I need to build a house for God. And God corrects it and says, nope, do not ever get out in front of me. And so to the point, we're never to try to get ahead of God. God will not be contained. God will choose God's messengers. And God's grace will correct us when we get, as my mother used to say, too big for our britches. So when we remember God's saying in Isaiah 55, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. We can begin to see that David's way of honoring God is not just rejected, it's reversed. And if we dig deep into that passage, we see that David is asking Nathan to bless David's project. And David has mixed motives. Because what's going to happen if David ends up building this great house for God? David's going to get all the credit. And so, while his expressed motives is to honor God, there's a reality that he really might want to be revered. And God can see that in us. So the usual procedure, like I said, is that he's supposed to go to Nathan and say, ask God what God thinks about this. And instead he says, this is what I want to have happen. And Nathan gets a little caught up in it. But you have to give Nathan credit. When God says go back and tell him he's wrong, Nathan delivers the message. Not an easy thing to do, I think, to King David. So where I'm going with this is that the bottom line is that God is calling us to reorient our lives. We know this Christmas story so well that we might get it wrong because it's become so ingrained in us, and God is asking us to take journeys that we might not want to take. He's asking us to remain prisoners of hope. And the messengers who tell us what God wants us to do in 2019 most likely aren't going to be winged cherubs. And there might just be ordinary people who need help or who show us where we need to change. So I need to reframe my sermon title. I asked where I'm going, and I need to change it to where is God sending us? I think the Christmas message for here at Peterborough United Methodist Church is to be prisoners of hope who are willing to change when God's journey for us involves going places that we might not choose, but where God is directing us to do all the good we can. I don't know about you, but I want to remain irrepressibly, I'm not going to say the word right, I want to remain a prisoner of hope, because what is the other way? Would you pray with me? Eternal God, we are your prisoners of hope, and we ask you to make very clear what you would like Peterborough United Methodist Church to do on earth as in heaven. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our final hymn today is Old Little Town of Bethlehem, number 230. And the large of the hymn. We stand as you're able to begin. That is hymn number 230. to celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we leave here today, let us remember this celebration every day of our lives. So go forth now with the peace and love and hope of Jesus Christ in your hearts. And don't hold them in your hearts. Pass them on to others that you meet. Go forth.